name is Grace. Ming and I have two beautiful girls, Sanine and Claire. Those of you who have been in Gashmo have seen me. I teach Tots and J1. Look forward to having your kids there. I'm also in Phoebe and Sian's LG, thanks to the family there as well. Yeah. So for today's scripture, Matthew 22:34-40. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the seducers, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, church. Morning. My name's David. I'm married to my wife, Jade, here. We have three kids. We've been part of the city for 6.5 years now, ever since we moved back from Australia. So actually, it's Father's Day. It's because of my father that my family is in this church. When I moved back from Australia, at the time, the founding pastor, Pastor Daniel, asked me, "Oh, would you preferably consider joining the city and making it your home?" And I said, "Oh, don't worry. My dad is there. My mom is there. My brother is here, so we're going to be here." And we've never looked back since. And I truly believe that our best days are before us as a church community, as long as we continue to keep God in the center. Amen? Amen. Since it's Father's Day, should I start off with a dad joke? Or? Now, you guys know dad jokes are really bad, right? So, okay. You guys might have heard this one before. Why do we say amen in church? Why do we say amen in church? Because we sing hymns, not hers. This is an appropriate response to a dad joke. Amen. This is good. We're off to a great start. So the message today that I feel to bring, just want to contextualize. It may be a bit uncomfortable to some of us, but please hear my heart. You know, when I was dating Jade, in our early days of dating, we always had miscommunications where I would say one thing, but she interpreted it as something negative. And I started getting really exasperated because I never meant to hurt her or harm her, but the word she was interpreting was coming off that way. So I just said, "Hey, everything I say, can you please help contextualize? I'm here, like I'm saying it for your benefit. Like I'm for you, I'm never against you." And so I'm sort of trying to contextualize as well that whatever I say, I do not mean for any guilt or shame to be released, but conviction, yes, in the name of Jesus. So let's bow our head and let's pray together before we get into it. Yeah, Father, we just thank you, God, for this time, Lord, and this day that you have made. Lord, we just commit, Lord, even this time, Lord, of listening to your word, to your hands, Lord. Father, I just pray that God, Holy Spirit, I just call to attention your spirit, Lord, in us to just reveal the depths of your heart and to really bring us an encounter, Lord, with you even today. And so, Lord, I just pray that, your spirit will be glorified even in the midst of this time that we have together. We love you, Lord. We acknowledge your presence here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So it started with a question for me. And the question was, what does a successful Christian look like? What does a successful Christian look like? What is a successful Christian? What does it mean to be a successful follower of Christ? How does a successful Christian look? And let's talk practical, right? Like, not loves God or honors your parents. Like, really, what comes to mind? Who comes to mind? And even more contextually, in modern-day Singapore, right, even in this church, are successful Christians here in this church? What does it mean to be a successful Christian? And I believe we immediately gravitate to certain elements. Maybe for some it's like, must be married. Married is successful. Must have kids. Has a nice house. Maybe a successful Christian is always smiling. Are they easy to talk to? Humble, wise? Are they a leader? Do they have a respectable job, yet love God deeply? What does a successful Christian look like to you? And in modern day Singapore, you know, we're all about KPIs, right? And we're all about, is this efficient? Is this productive? So for me, I was wondering, you know, in my life in Christ, as a disciple, as a follower of Christ, am I on track to achieving success? What's the KPI for a life centered on the belief in Jesus? How do I know I'm being a successful Christian? And I landed on a concept which I will title my message today, which is success is intimacy. Success is intimacy. I believe that the KPI, the key performance indicator for a successful life as a professing believer and follower of Christ, is intimacy. The answer to the question of what a successful Christian looks like is intimacy. It's not necessarily being married. It's not necessarily having kids. Intimacy with God is primary, and also with people. So intimate with God and intimate with people. Now, what does this mean? Does this mean that that all that we work towards every day is meaningless? Does it mean that outcomes don't matter? As long as we have relationship with God, as long as we intimate with God, what does intimacy with God look like? And I don't think I can comprehensively cover this, but let's start the conversation today. And again, I'll be focusing a bit more on intimacy with God primarily. So I think of a friend that I've known since I was a teenager, and he's not here today, so that's good. No names. When he got married, he and his wife were in agreement that they didn't want any kids. So they didn't want to have kids, and there was no arguing about that. They were like, yeah, we're not going to have kids. A few years into their marriage, my friend met up with another friend, and this friend asked him, you know, oh, why don't you guys have kids? And so he said, oh, no, we've decided, yeah, me and my wife decided we're not going to have kids. And the friend asked him a question, have you involved God in this situation? Have you involved God in this decision? And that sort of stuck with him, and so he took it back and he spoke to his wife about it, you know, have we involved God in this decision not to have kids? And so, long story short is that they decided to allow God into the situation. I won't go into the details of what that looks like and what that means. But now they have two kids. And so, I believe that the moment they decided to let God into that situation, that was success. That was intimacy. That was saying, God, we want this part of our lives to be with you. And I believe that life was always meant to be walked with God, close to God. That we were always meant to regard Him in everything. And it's important that we recognize that our lives are always meant to be in Christ. So I have a few verses here. Colossians 3, verse 3. It says, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. Romans 8, verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And 2 Corinthians 5, 17, therefore if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. You know, we sing songs like, it's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that lives in me. And what does that mean? Here's how I see it. So, you know, I mean, I grew up in church. So I was a life group leader when I was in secondary school. I've been part of the youth group. I've been part of the worship team. And I've heard it often said, you know, okay, don't serve like when we're doing ministry, you know, like whether you're an usher team or you're leading a life group, don't serve for God. Serve with God. Anybody heard that before? So this is how I picture it, right? Say, this is God, right? Say, God is here. And so for me, it's like I don't want to do the things that I do in ministry for God. Say I build these things or I lead this thing and I say, God, see what I've built for you. We don't want to do that. But it says serve with God. So God, I want to do this with you. Imagine this is like God. But then what does the Bible say? The Bible says that we are in Christ Jesus. So it's not so much I do things for God or I do things with God, but I do things in Christ. And that's sort of how I just had this mental image of that. And in Acts 17, verse 28, it says, in him we live and move and have our being. I'll grab Tim for a second. Visual demonstration. Oh, hey, round of applause for Tim. Oh, yeah, Tim. Can you like stretch your arms out? So this is the way I see it. For example, like, okay, so this is God. So Tim is in God, right? John verse 15, verse 5 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. So imagine Tim is the branch. Out, out, straight in there. I'm the vine, you are the branches. So for me, it's like the vine is like all around, right? And we are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Thank you, Tim. Round of applause for Tim for being the branches. So for me, that's how it looks. You know, in him we live and move and have our being. We are the branches. He's the vine. Wherever we go, whatever we do, everything we do can be an opportunity for intimacy. Recognize that our lives are in Christ. When we walk here or there, when we go for lunch later, when we pick up KFC for the fathers, we are in Christ. When we go to sleep, we're in Christ. So let's get practical, okay? Why do we pray and worship? Why do we set aside time during our day, during our week, to pray and worship? It's to commune with God. It's to be intimate with God. Why do we read the Bible? Jesus is the Word made flesh. So we cultivate intimacy with Christ when we meditate on his Word and allow our faith to be built, the Holy Spirit to reveal. Why do we come to church? Why do we go to life group? Why do we meet? It's because, you know, God told us that he delights in his people coming together in unity to build each other up. Why do we spend time with our family, even if our family maybe are non-Christians? God put us in families. He operates in families. And he desires for us to learn, to live, and to love in families. When we live as he designed us in Christ, we bring glory to him and we are intimate with him. Why do we spend time with our children, parents? Why do we train them up? We manifest the love of God and demonstrate it to them, to show them loving correction, loving communion. Why do we eat and drink? Okay, there's another verse here. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31. I'm not sure if you guys have noticed this one before, but it says, so whenever you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. And so I'm like, eat and drink, and that's like my worship. That's how God is glorified when I eat or drink. Has anybody ever wondered why we were created to eat and drink? I was wondering it like, God, why did you create us to eat and drink? Why can't we be like plants and just photosynthesize and survive by sunlight and water? I believe that God created us to eat and drink is so that we can be intimate with God and with each other. I mean, look at the life of Jesus, right? He was always sharing meals. We know what the communion table is, the communion elements, eating and drinking. So I believe that God designed us for intimacy. Success is intimacy. Why do we go on holidays and celebrate events and birthdays? You know, why do we feast and celebrate? My younger brother is getting married in 2 months' time. So he's busy getting ready for the big celebration. Jesus' first miracle was at a wedding celebration, right? Why? Why? God ordained feasts, the Passover feast, the so many feasts. Finally, why do we go to work? How can going to work be an opportunity to cultivate intimacy with God? I want to introduce us to this word. It's a Hebrew word, and it's called avoda. Can we try and say that? Avoda. It's a Hebrew word which contains the meaning of worship, serving, and work. So in the Hebrew language, there is one word that means three different things in English. It means worship, it means work, and it means service. So actually, God created us for work. Our work is our worship. Whenever we talk about worship, we always think singing songs and being intimate with God, expressing our love for Him, allowing His love to wash over us. God actually intended for us at work to be at worship as well. Here's a quote that I found in a book called Worship. It says, if you are engaged in an activity, any activity at work or home or play, and it cannot be done in a form of worship, then it should not be done. Any activity at work, at home, or play, and it cannot be done. Our life is in Christ. I believe this is echoed in the verse in Colossians 3, verse 17, which says, and whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. So success in everything we do really is intimacy. Have we regarded God in this situation? Or are we keeping things away from God? From Him are all things, and to Him are all things. How do we know we are successful then? How do we know that we are being truly intimate? I believe it's when we become like Him and when we do His works out of an overflow, out of an outflow of intimacy. Okay, I've got one more illustration. And this hasn't always gone down well when I've shared this revelation like excitedly to like my life group and some friends, and they always look at me a bit strange, but I'm just going to share it. So I'm a guy that when I watch movies, sometimes I get revelations of principles in the kingdom, right? Anybody like that? You watch movies, you're like, wow, yeah. So I had a revelation of how Holy Spirit interacts with us. How Holy Spirit interacts with us. And this was in the movie Venom. I do, caveat, I do not recommend the movie. Don't look it up. If you don't know the movie Venom, don't look it up. Dad, mom, do not look up the movie. The images are... But, okay, so what? I'll explain. Venom is an alien life form, okay? It's a symbiote, a powerful alien species that forges a bond with a host, a human, granting them incredible abilities. And Venom basically inhabits this person, and in the movie Venom, inhabits this character that's played by Tom Hardy, right? And what was interesting was when they were introducing how when Venom was a part of this human, like Tom Hardy, the character, the human, was sitting in his like apartment and then he gets attacked by enemies and Venom, being like fused or inside this human, is able to speak and like tell the character like, oh, there's an enemy coming, or like move here, do this, do that. Basically protects, right? The good guy from the bad guy. And then fast forward to the end of the movie where the character of Tom Hardy is talking to his love interest. And Venom is there like talking to the guy in his head as well. So he's basically having a conversation with his love interest, and Venom is also having a conversation prompting him in that conversation. So it's sort of like everywhere that the character goes, Venom goes with him. A disclaimer, Holy Spirit is not like Venom. It's just the relationship. Holy Spirit is not a parasitic symbiote. But the interaction, you know. Christ in me, the hope of glory. wherever I go, Holy Spirit is. When I abide, the vine doesn't go anywhere, like, but Christ in me and I in Christ. Let's go to another movie, Chariots of Fire, a bit more godly. We know the story of Eric Little in Chariots of Fire, who refused to run on a Sunday. And there's the famous quote there that Eric Little said, God made me fast, and when I run, I feel his pleasure. Now, we are all made different, so not everybody feels this pleasure when we run. But what is your superpower? What is the gift that God has given you? For some, it's running. For others, it's cooking. Is it drawing? Singing? Hiking? Could we modify the quote to be like, God made me a good writer. When I write, I feel his pleasure. Or God made me an activator. When I activate things or people, I feel his pleasure. God made me a good communicator. When I relate, I feel his pleasure. Or maybe God made me a teacher. When I'm able to impart knowledge, I feel his pleasure. God made me a good coffee barista. When I make good coffee, I feel his pleasure. Everybody say amen? Amen. Why do we do what we do? What is our motivation? You know, I believe God wants to be involved in our everyday lives, in everything that we do. Waking, sleeping, everything. I think of the family that was deciding whether or not the husband and wife had different opinions on where to go for a family holiday. One wanted to go to Hong Kong, one wanted to go to Penang. What did they do? They got the family together and they prayed about it, asked Holy Spirit. They ended up going to Hong Kong. Just if you wanted to know. That was for them. I think of the sales manager in the global hotel chain who has millions of dollars in sales targets to meet each period. He calls for Christians in his team. So secular company, global company. He calls the Christians in his team to come every day on a Monday during lunchtime. And they pray together. Success is intimacy. It's not necessarily in achieving goals or targets per se. Achieving is merely the vehicle in which we can cultivate and grow our intimacy in Christ. Now, does that mean that we don't give it our all? No. But rather, we give it our all because Christ has given us all that we have and all that we are. Christ created us for purpose. Why do we go around looking for, you know, what's your purpose? What's God's will for my life? It's because that's an opportunity to be intimate with God. God, what do you want for me? I want to be all that you have created me to be. And so my motivation is to be intimate with you, but I will do great exploits with you. And when we live out our God-given purposes, I believe that he is glorified. When we manifest the gifts that God has given us, we glorify him. You guys doing okay? Yeah. Do you guys know about the secret of eternal life? Just casually, the secret of eternal life. It says, and I don't have this on the slide, but it says in John 17, so I heard this from a preacher who, he was saying that, you know, God told him, ask me about the secret of eternal life. And so he said, okay, God, what's the secret to eternal life? And he said, go to John 17, verse 3. In John 17, verse 3, it says, now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. The secret to eternal life is knowing God. Now, I know we heard a message a couple weeks ago from Pastor Janice about God knowing us. Further from that, I believe that in the Bible, you know, knowing in the Bible is a lot more, it has a lot more to do with relationship than it has to do with knowledge. Because we see in Genesis that Adam knew Eve and they had a child. So it's not so much about knowledge, but it's more about relationship. And the secret to eternal life is knowing God. It's to be intimate with God. Success is intimacy. All right, I've just got three short points just to talk about that, and then we can wrap up. But number one is obedience. Obedience. John 14, verse 15 says, if you love me, keep my commands. And John 10, verse 27 says, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. You know, in a church camp last year, we had this moment of sharing where Pastor Andrew Gardner sort of opened the mic and allowed all of us as a community to shine a light on stuff, whatever we felt Holy Spirit asking us to shine a light on. And I had the opportunity to share that I felt that I was not being obedient because I said, I think it was earlier that day or the day before, I saw this man, because we were in Doubletree, JB, and I saw this man who was in a cast, and at that moment I felt Holy Spirit just say, you know, pray for the guy, pray for his leg. And I was like, no, that's weird, and that's strange. And I just kept having this internal battle with Holy Spirit until the guy took the lift and it's like, okay, he's gone now. Sorry, God, I'll do it next time. How many of us have been in that situation before? And so I was given the opportunity to sort of share that during that time of sharing that we had. I think it was the next day or even that same day that I was in the corridor with my core brother, Mike. And I don't know, I think I was holding a baby or something. And then the next thing I hear Mike say, here we go. And I turn around and I see the guy with the crutch or whatever. And I was like, I didn't even think. I just gave the baby off and I just, hey, can I pray for you? And the guy was like, yeah, sure. I mean, I just did my thing. I said the prayer. I mean, I'm still a work in progress, okay? So I didn't check and all that. But I believe obedience is getting past ourselves, right? Getting past the fear of man. Not allowing the fear of man to affect our decisions. And that is an act of intimacy. To cultivate intimacy, we want to regard Christ in every decision that we make. You know, as married couples, we talk about how we come to agreement. Some couples say, okay, maybe the husband's the expert in this area. Some people say, okay, the wife has been nagging me in this area for so long, so I'll just give in. We say that's not God's way of coming to agreement. Agreement, God's way, is both husband and wife holding hands and saying, Holy Spirit, what do you want us to do in this situation? Every opportunity, everything that we face is an opportunity for intimacy. And in most activities throughout my day, I try, again, I'm a work in progress, right? As we all are. I try to regard God in everything. God, do you want me to watch this movie now? Venom. Should I listen to this podcast, Lord? Holy Spirit, should I take this route or that? I remember the time that I had to go to an embassy for, this was in the middle of COVID. I had to go to an embassy to settle some administrative things. I had to go all the way down. And then I turn up at the embassy and I realize that you can only make an appointment and you have to send an email how many days beforehand. And so I'm like, oh, my whole trip is a waste. Like, and then I start having this conversation with Holy Spirit. I say, Holy Spirit, why didn't you tell me that I had to make an appointment? You know, you could have brought somebody to tell me, oh, you're going to this embassy, you need to make an appointment. How come? Why am I here? You know? And as I was just, I tried to do all that I could, try and make an appointment, try to get on the phone, couldn't do it. I had to go home. I was like, I wasted my time. And as I was walking back to my transport, a car pulls up next to me. And I see my good friend in the car, and he's like, what are you doing here? And I'm like, what are you doing here? This is a COVID, so we haven't seen each other, right? And then I was like, ah, now I know why Holy Spirit brought me all the way here. It's because my friend was having an operation that day, minor operation, but I was like, okay, I guess I'm meant to pray with you. And I guess it's about remaining curious with Holy Spirit throughout the day. I mean, our lives are in Christ, right? We have this voice that is not venom, but it's the Holy Spirit that's speaking to us and desires to be intimate with us in our everyday lives. Success is intimacy. Point two, desperation. In Psalm verse 84, and I believe we spoke about this a little bit just now, even after the worship session, you know. Psalm 84 says, "How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." How many times have we experienced that desire for God where it's to the point where our heart and our flesh cry out for the living God? You know, I don't do well, now that I'm a married man, I don't do well without my wife for extended periods of time. That's just how wonderful my wife is, you know. I wake up in the morning sometimes, I just like, oh, how wonderful my wife. I get two boxes against here, then, thanks. Score points. No, but so in November, right, last year, November, my brother's based in Houston, and there was an extended period of time where my wife and the kids went to Houston first. And I was without my wife around for about 10 days. And that, I guess, was the closest I experienced to, like, my heart and my flesh. I am so upset. I'm so, like, longing for the presence of my wife. My house is too quiet. The kids are not here, but it's really my wife that I want to be right next to me. Have we lost our desperation for the presence of God? To be intimate to the point where our heart and our flesh cry out, God, I need you. Every day I need you. You know, the story of the woman with the alabaster jar in Matthew 26, it completely makes no sense to me unless we view it from a perspective of success being intimacy. Because if we audit it from like a ministry perspective, like, okay, are the funds being deployed in a productive way? What's the purpose of this ministry? You know, it's a year's worth of wages, which is a lot of money, that's in this jar, alabaster jar perfume. It's being broken. It makes no sense. You know, in modern day Singapore, are the lost being reached? Are the poor being fed? But she was desperate. She didn't care what the men in the room thought. She was desperate for intimacy with Christ. And you know, we sing songs like, I just want to move your heart. Lord, I'm desperate for you. I'm lost without you. We sing, I stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. What does that mean on a day-to-day basis? Where everything we do in our lives is as worship to God. Even in our work, it's as worship to God. Even when we sleep, when we wake, it's all as worship to God. Where we don't move from that place where we're in God, when we're abiding in Him, when we remain in Him. Last point. So there's obedience, there's desperation, and the last point is surrender. You know, in John chapter 6, so the scene is that Jesus had just preached this sermon, which was very offensive to His disciples. He was preaching about eating my flesh, drink my blood. The disciples said, this is hard teaching. Many were offended. John 6, verse 67, Jesus asked, he said, you do not want to leave too, do you? Jesus asked the 12. And Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God. Even though the disciples of Simon Peter didn't understand, they were surrendered. They surrendered their right to understand, and yet they desired to continue to pursue intimacy with Christ. You know, I believe surrender, true surrender, is giving God everything we have. Our possessions, that means our house, what's in our bank account, it's God's, surrendered. Our disappointments, are we disappointed about anything? Are we frustrated about anything? We surrender, we give it to God. Anxious. The Bible says, be anxious for nothing. But in everything, bring it to God in prayer. Even in anxiety, it's an invitation for intimacy. God says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, bring it to me in prayer. Stay intimate. And I believe even forgiveness is an act of surrender. You know, maybe there's hurt that we have, or disappointment, or frustration with somebody. When we choose to release forgiveness, we're choosing to say, God, I surrender this to you. Repentance is an act of surrender. And surrendering the right to understand. As I start to come to a close, this was just an experience of mine. At the beginning of, just as COVID was hitting in 2020, my close Sunday school friend, so a guy that I'd known since Sunday school, he passed away from cancer. He left behind his wife and two young daughters. Now this, his passing took me by surprise because he had been fighting this bout of cancer for about a year. And I guess what happened was when he was diagnosed and all that, you know, me and some other friends, we came together, we started praying for him. He would be in hospital, we prayed for him, and then he'd get better. And then like a week later, his condition just went down again. And so we come in, we pray, his condition got better, went down again. And so it went through a few cycles of that, but we always knew in our heads, our mind, God is a healer. And so we believed that, you know, he would be healed from cancer. And so when, after a year of fighting, he suddenly just, it went downhill and he passed away. It took me by surprise. I was like, God, this wasn't, he's got two young daughters. You know, they are Bible-believing, sold out for you Christians. Why did he pass away? And so I knew that it sort of affected my grieving process. I knew that there was unresolved business that I had with God. And so 2 years later, so it was probably 1 or 2 years ago, 2 or 3 years later, there was a service. This was in TBI. And Pastor Janice, I can't remember what she was speaking on, but she gave the call, you know, if anybody has any unresolved business or something they want to bring with God, you know, come to the altar. And I just felt a tugging of the Holy Spirit in that moment. I wasn't sure what it was because I was like, you know, why God heals, why God doesn't heal, I won't understand it. So I'll just leave it alone. Who am I? But I just felt that a tugging of God, of Holy Spirit in that moment to come up. And I was wrestling in my mind because I'm like, I've been a Christian for 30 years now, you know, and I'm a leader in the church, and there was not many people responding. But I just felt, you know, obedience, right? So Holy Spirit said, come up. So, okay. And I ended up, this was in TPI, so I ended up kneeling at the front there. And I found tears coming down my eyes as I started grieving the death of this beloved brother. And I realized that I was disappointed. I was angry with God for not healing him. And in my time of, you know, just doing business with God, I mean, people were praying for me. It was great. But I had this impression of God kneeling there beside me and weeping as well. And that really riled me up. I was like, Jesus, why are you weeping? You could have healed him. Why are you weeping? And then I was impressed by that shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. We may not understand, but Jesus wants us to be intimate with him. And he meets us where we are, in our very moment of need, wherever we are. Jesus wept. And so, yeah, that's pretty much all I have for this morning. I believe that God wants to remind us that success is not in achieving. It's really in being intimate with him. Because like the Bible verse that was read at the beginning, all the law and prophets hang on this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. And love your neighbor as yourself. I have a couple of reflection questions that maybe can guide our response. And the first one is, how are you enjoying Holy Spirit these days? Are we abiding in him? Are we aware of his presence in our lives? Are we enjoying Holy Spirit? And the second one is this: is there an area in your life that is holding you back from intimacy with God or with people? Are you holding anything back from God? Is there anything that we need to surrender? Is there any forgiveness or repentance that is needed? You know, we've gone through the freedom that you long for series, and does God want us to be free of anything, even in this moment? Do we need to even repent of not being desperate for God, of not loving Him with the love that He desires? So let's stand this morning. Thank you, Lord. You know, even as it's Father's Day today, this week, just at bedtime, I was putting my kids to bed, and my daughter, my second daughter, my 8-year-old daughter, said, "Daddy, how much do you love me?" And my heart was really moved in that moment, because she just asked that simple question: "Daddy, how much do you love me?" And I believe some of us maybe need to ask God that question. And it surprised me that it moved me so much, because to me it showed that she wanted to be intimate with me, and she wanted to know how I felt about her. And so let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank you that you desire us so much more. No matter what we're facing, no matter what we're thinking, no matter what we're doing, Holy Spirit, even right now, give us your conviction, God. It's not through striving that we need to be better people. You are already satisfied with us. You are already so proud of us. You're already so pleased with us. But Lord, sometimes we may not feel that. Sometimes we may not realize that. Lord, even in this moment, I just pray that you cause us to realign our lives, to live our lives in you above all things.